Our world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, SLCTV will feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair, because the lecture hall is about to begin.
When I started Orca, it was with the idea of protecting the ocean I love. Thank you. I would have missed those. Transformed a bit recently. I still want to protect the ocean I love, but I'm also very concerned about us humans getting protected, because we're at greater risk than I would have imagined. It's almost like the ocean is fighting back. So when I first moved here in 1989, the Indian River Lagoon was known as the most biologically diverse estuary in the United States. I seriously doubt that it can claim that any longer. We have quite a different reputation, unfortunately, nationally and even internationally. It's actually impacting tourism. People are canceling their trips to Florida because of our algae reports. As Kermit the Frog says, it's not easy being green. And a lot of the businesses that live on the water, depend on the water, are feeling that very strongly. But it isn't just being green, we're actually quite colorful. We have three major harmful algal blooms that we're dealing with in Florida right now. We have a red tide, a brown tide, and blue-green algae. Red tide is actually an alga called a dinoflagellate. Brown tide is also an alga, and oddly enough, the one thing called algae, the blue-green algae, isn't even algae. It's a type of bacteria, cyanobacteria. For those of you that experienced the red tide this October, did any of you have direct experience with breathing that? It was excruciating. It closed our beaches. I took this picture on my beach up on North Hutchinson Island. To deal with all of the dead animal life that came up on the beaches, the county came in with earth-moving gear, and they made these burial mounds every 100 yards or so. I wasn't actually quite sure it was a great idea when I saw them doing it, but actually it worked pretty well because it kept down the flies and it kept down the smell, and then they got washed out with the next tide. What you're seeing there is just what washed up after they came through. So it was a very deadly tide. And it definitely impacted tourism, because you couldn't go to the beach without wearing a mask. Having a red tide come around to this coast is not unique. It's happened before. Since the 1950s, when they started tracking this, it's come around from the west coast 8 times. It's carried by what's called the loop current. The last time it happened was about more than 10 years ago. So it's a relatively rare occurrence, and we hope it doesn't happen too often, because it was extremely impactful. The reason that they call them red tides is because certain species, when they're in high enough concentration, actually turn the water red. This is the California red tide organism, which actually, interestingly, both of these red tide organisms also turn the water blue at night because they're bioluminescent. But our particular type of red tide actually turns the water gold. It's a dinoflagellate called Carinia brevis. All of these dinoflagellates produce toxins. The one we're dealing with is called brevetoxin. And one of the concerns with these toxin producers is that they get into the food web and they concentrate as they move up the food chain. So the way it usually proceeds is you've got the plankton being, the algae being eaten by plankton, which are eaten by small fish, bigger fish, concentrate that toxin even further, and by the time you get to the game fish, you have really high concentrations of the toxins that can be lethal to anyone that eats them. Now, we used to think that brevetoxin, our particular type of red tide toxin, didn't bioaccumulate the way some of these others do, partly because it's just so deadly that it kills the fish before they even get a chance to accumulate it. But it turns out that that's not true. In 2004, there was a mass mortality of dolphins, bottlenose dolphins up in the panhandle. And when they necropsied those dolphins, they discovered that they did have brevetoxin in their flesh and they had menhaden in their gut. That also had brevetoxin in the fish tissues. And so one of the things that we've been doing at Orca is we've been catching fish from various locations to look for these various toxins. And the brevetoxin was in the fish at the time of the fish kill that we tested. And there was still low dosages in some of the offshore fish, but it disappeared pretty quickly. The other, another one we've been dealing with is a brown tide in the northern part of the Indian River Lagoon. It literally turns the water brown. It's not toxic, but it's still been pretty deadly because it blocks out the sunlight, and so the seagrass meadows have died. And we actually did have a major, major fish kill up there in 2016 on the night of March 19th. The oxygen levels dropped to zero. This is some of the data from our water quality monitors called Kilroy. This one was in the Sykes Creek. And so you're seeing both the oxygen dropping and the the brown alga dying off. And so as it's dying off, it's being consumed by bacteria that are sucking the oxygen out of the water, which then left nothing for the fish, and so there was just an absolutely massive fish kill up there. It was just devastating. All different kinds of species. It was so much that they didn't actually quantify it. It was just too overwhelming. And then on top of that, we've had this blue-green algae that has been plaguing us in the St. Lucie Estuary. And this was what it looked like in 2016. That's not photoshopped or anything. That's exactly what it looked like. And this past year, we had a major bloom again in Lake Okeechobee and was seen in the Caloosahatchee River and the St. Lucie Estuary. And this one is very concerning because it produces a toxin called microcystin. And it is what is known as a hepatotoxin, which means it's a liver toxin. It attacks the liver. And actually, one reason that we know as much as we do about microcystin is because of studies in China. A lot of their drinking water is contaminated with microcystin. And so this connection to liver cancer is pretty well established. The interesting thing about microcystin is it has both an acute and a chronic effect. So if you drink water with microcystin in it, it can actually kill you. Fortunately, there have been very, very few human fatalities. There's quite a few animal fatalities related to microcystin consumption. Cattle drinking water that has it in it have died. There have been instances of dogs that died. the one instance, bad instance for humans was in Brazil in 1996 when, unfortunately, a dialysis clinic got some microcystin containing water, and 131 dialysis patients were exposed. Of those, 100 had acute liver failure, and of those, 176 people died. So the thing that's kind of scary about this molecule is that it, oh, thank you.
Sorry.
No, that's much appreciated. It's incredibly stable. You can boil this sucker, and it doesn't denature. And it's incredibly toxic. So it's so toxic that the World Health Organization sets the limit in drinking water at one part per billion. That's the equivalent of one drop in a tanker truck full of water. That's very toxic. They set the limit of recreational exposure at 10 parts per billion. Now, this isn't just theoretical. We may already be being impacted by this. Because there was a study that came out of Ohio State University in 2015 where they looked nationwide for a correlation between toxic algae blooms and non-alcohol related liver disease. And any place they found a high correlation, they put a red spot. Well, you'll note there's one red spot right here in Florida, all around the Indian River Lagoon and Lake Okeechobee. Our suspicion is that this is probably due to the number of subsistence fishermen we've all come home from the airport at midnight and seen people fishing off the bridges. They're not recreational fishermen. They're trying to put food on their tables, and they eat a lot of these fish. So they're getting a very heavy exposure, and actually we're doing some studies right now to try to quantify the amount of exposure. That's not the only possible path of exposure, but we think it's the one most likely to be accounting for the high correlation that we have seen here. It's very important when seeing a study like this to recognize that correlation is not causation. It's not proof. It's just an area for concern. So there are a number of different paths of toxin exposure. One, as I mentioned, was in drinking water. They had an instance of this at Lake Erie. In fact, they've had several instances, but the worst case was in August 2014 when there was a bloom on Lake Erie so intense it could be seen by satellite. And this is the drinking water intake for the Toledo water plant. And they shut down water supply for 500,000 customers. And this was not a boil notice. This was a do not even touch notice. What's interesting to me about these toxins is that there are actually no national standards for cyanotoxins in drinking water. And there's no requirement that drinking water plants test for it. If the water turns green, they do, generally. And some of them have ozonators and other types of treatment that will handle the microcystin, but not all of them do. Another way that you can be exposed is by aerosolization, and it turns out that that's an actually pretty easy way to be exposed. It'll be taken up through your nasal passages very, very easily. In fact, in studies with mice, they found that it was absorbed better through the nasal passages than through an intraperitoneal injection. And Harbor Branch did a study of people down around the St. Lucie Estuary last summer, and of all of those that they tested where they did nose swabs to see if they had any microcystin, 100% had microcystin in their nasal passages. And if you've been around one of these blooms, it is nasty. I went down there on a couple of occasions to get samples. I was exposed for maybe all of 15 minutes, and I was sick for 24 hours afterwards. I mean, I was right up close to it, but you know, it makes your throat sore, your eyes burn, it gives you a headache and makes you nauseous. And Memorial Hospital saw a major increase in admissions related to this microcystis bloom. Microcystin can also be taken up by food crops. It's not as concentrated as in fish, but when you think about something like corn, which we eat a lot of, or sugar, or any of the other products that can take up microcystin, it could potentially become significant. There's a lot less research on this, but it's something that I think we need to be thinking about here in Florida because of the way we do agriculture here. In order to create land that we could grow things on, we dug all these canals to drain the swamp. But then we use these same canals to irrigate the land. And what we've found with our water quality monitors is that there's a potential problem with that. So we got funding in 2014 that allowed us to put 25 of our water quality monitors, called Kilroys, in all of the major canals and tributaries that feed into the Indian River Lagoon. Unfortunately, in 2017, that funding got cut, so we only have 10 of them out there under state funding right now, and 3 under county funding. We learned an awful lot from having those out there, and one of the things we learned was that there was something that we call cryptic algae blooms occurring in these canals. And they were cryptic in the sense that you didn't actually see the green slime on the surface of the canal, but our sensors were telling us that there was blue-green algae occurring, and we sampled it, and it was microcystis. There are studies, quite a few of them, showing that food crops take up microcystin. This was one that came out at the end of 2017 in Food Research International that showed uptake of microcystin by lettuce, carrots, and green beans. But the thing that was most interesting about this was how much it impacted crop yield. Now, when you do science, one of the hallmarks of good science is you repeat other people's experiments to test them. And we did that. We wanted to just convince ourselves that lettuce actually took up microcystin. So we were irrigating a little patch of lettuce with 10 parts per billion microcystin and another little patch with just regular water, sitting right by side by side. And the, you know, this lettuce looked nice and healthy as you'd expect, and this was all shriveled over here. Well, that's apparently very common, and there's other literature showing it. So this is the lettuce that they grew under 0, 1, 5, and 10 parts per billion. Carrots, 0, 1, 5, and 10, and green beans. And you can see how shriveled and small the green beans have become. Well, what does a farmer do when he sees his crop yield going down? He adds more fertilizer, which feeds the algae, which produces more microcystin, which then goes on the crops, and we're in a vicious cycle. And so I've actually been trying to talk to agriculture about this to try to, you know, get across this information that the farmers could actually improve their yield if they would start doing things that would reduce the amount of fertilizer that's getting into the canals. Besides ourselves, we also have to worry about our pets, because they swim in this water. They've been, you know, just wading in it and then licking their paws. They can end up getting some of this microcystin, or worse, eating some of the dead fish that were a result of the algae bloom. In fact, we actually did have one dog die. This is Finn, a 9-year-old standard poodle, and he was brought in with liver failure. And you know, the vets had no idea what was going on, but the community of vets around here talk to each other, which is great. So some other dogs started coming in showing similar symptoms, and they figured it out pretty fast, and they started flushing the livers, and they saved all those other dogs. But you know, it was pretty alarming how quickly these dogs were impacted by exposure. There's other toxins that algae can produce, cyanobacteria in particular. One of the scariest ones is BMAA, beta-methylaminoalanine. This one is something that our body mistakes for serine, which is a normal amino acid, and takes it up, and then our proteins misfold, and you form plaques in the brain that are connected to Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, and Lou Gehrig's disease. And there's a long story that goes along with this BMAA, and I refer you to a very excellent documentary called Toxic Puzzle, which you can see on Netflix, which gives you some science background, and even amazingly some hope, because they actually found something that might actually make a difference. So when you're looking at all of these red tide, brown tide, cyanobacterial bloom, the common denominator on the causes is they're all caused by nutrient pollution. In the red tide and brown tide, which are in the saltwater environment, it's primarily nitrogen that is the polluter. And in freshwater environments, it's primarily phosphate. That's not always true, but as a general rule, it's frequently true. So where's the pollution coming from? Well, an awful lot of it is coming from what's called non-point source pollution. So it's fertilizer, not to mention pesticides, coming off of cropland with rain or snow melt up north, and actually biosolids as well, which are applied as fertilizer. Animal waste from animal farm feed farms, just deforestation or stripping the land, you can end up with particles in the water that block out the sunlight and hurt the gills of the fish. We have a toxic cocktail of all kinds of petroleum related chemicals that go off, come off of our parking lots and roads every time there's a rainstorm. We have leaky septic systems. Air pollution is actually a fairly major contributor for nitrogen. We have Florida is basically a coal-burning state, and air pollution is actually quite significant. And then motorboats not only release petroleum products, but they stir up the legacy pollution in the form of the muck that's on the bottom of the lagoon. So my organization, ORCA, has a tagline of mapping pollution, finding solutions. We're an applied science organization. We're investigative scientists that are trying to find where the pollution is coming from, primarily, and then what we can do to get it stopped. So I mentioned the Kilroys. These are water quality monitors that we developed. They're real-time, wireless, relatively low cost compared to anything else on the market. They're easy to install, and they measure a whole range of parameters. Kilroys, for example, measure the blue-green algae, which is they're the only ones that do right now in the Indian River Lagoon. And we even have met stations that give us the weather to relate it to. So a Kilroy is attached to this yellow fiberglass pole. The sensor system is underwater here. Kilroy's voice, the telemetry unit is basically just cell phone technology, and the whole thing is powered by a solar panel. So with this arrangement, we can actually do an installation in 20 minutes, although I generally point out that it's 20 minutes plus 3 months for the permit. The value of what these can give us, I just can't emphasize enough in terms of figuring out the science and figuring out where the problems are, just how critical real-time monitoring is. So for example, this is some data from recently this is 10 Mile Creek, and so blue is nitrogen, green is phosphorus, and we had, this was in the middle of January, we started to get some rain, so 0.2 inches, 0.3 inches, 1.6 inches. And so you get this significant pulse of nitrogen and a smaller pulse of phosphate that came off the land. And this is primarily agricultural in origin. If you look at 10 Mile Creek out here, this goes all the way down to where we are down here. This is all 10 Mile Creek. But it's draining all of this farmland out to the west. And when they did some revamping of the highway here, they put in a canal weir right there. And so this used to drain to the south, and now it drains out of 10 Mile Creek. So we've been seeing a lot more nutrients coming out of 10 Mile Creek. But with that rain event, we also saw it coming out of other places like the C-23 Canal. So it was, it drained off the agricultural land. This is a plot that I plotted from today, so it's only a few hours old. And this is this coming out of the C-44 Canal. So they opened the gates from Lake Okeechobee on Saturday, and that happened right here. And within, it takes a couple of days for whatever's coming out of Lake Okeechobee to reach our sensor at the Palm City Bridge. But this is a very high level of nitrogen that's now coming out and will be coming out for the next 21 days, because that's how long the gates are going to be open. And this phosphorus level is extremely high. A lot of the time it's been so saturated with phosphate coming out of Lake Okeechobee. Another way that we look at pollution is we have been mapping the pollution that we find in the sediment, this black mayonnaise that smothers the bottom of the lagoon. We go out and we take samples of that and we test it for a whole lot of different pollutants, including the nutrients. And we create maps like this one, just like a weather map where red is hot and blue is cold. This is a pollution map. You'll note that this is so different than what you see over here, where you've got all living shoreline. And interestingly, even what you see around the moorings golf course, So all of the homes around the moorings are pretty typical Florida landscaping, where you've got grass coming right down to the edge of the seawall, usually with a pretty steep slope. So the only thing that can possibly happen when you mow that lawn is that the grass clippings end up in the water. Well, for any of you that are organic farmers, you already know this, but grass makes a wonderful fertilizer. You just put it in what they call a bioreactor, which is a fancy name because all you need to do is take your grass clippings, throw them in a bucket with some water, and add a little aquarium pump. And in 3 days, you'll have what's called grass tea, which is fertilizer that you can use to fertilize your crops with organic fertilizer. So every time we mow our lawns, we're feeding the algae monster. And it isn't just the people on the waterfront, because if you go inland, the yard crews blow all the grass clippings into the gutters, which then feed into the drains that feed into the Indian River Lagoon, usually with no baffle boxes whatsoever. Now, a lot of other communities up north have figured this out. So up in Virginia, they've started to incentivize homeowners to have setbacks, as they call them, deep-rooted plants, and not have the grass go right up to the edge of the seawall. In Tampa Bay, where they've started to actually turn things around, they realized that one of the problems they had was, and we do this here, when they mow the swales along the side of the road, they just left the grass in the swale. And then it would come out as a big slug into Tampa Bay and feed the algae. So now they collect all of the grass from the swales and they put it in the landfill, and it's made a big difference. We could be doing that. The moorings, to their credit, didn't like that map, but they didn't take it in the wrong way. They decided to try to make a difference. And so they've been leaders in the community. And so this is what their waterfront used to look like, and they've now replanted it with deep-rooted plants all along the seawall. And just a matter of a few months, it grew in very nicely, and is actually, I think, very pretty. Should have been one more. No. The next best thing you could do is to put in a swale. And so you have a swale and a berm with the deep-rooted plants on the berm to collect the, so this swale collects the water, and then the roots, you know, take up the nutrients. And so that's an even better way to mediate the problem. And so that's what we did at my home, because I live on a deep water dock community that wouldn't let me do anything any more radical than this. But what we did was we put in a swale, and we planted all of these native plants, muley grass, perennial peanut, sunshine mimosa. We put in something called reef wall that provides habitat for animals. And we collect every bit of water that comes off of our property. We have French drains all over our property that feed into a tank, and then we use that water to irrigate our lawn. So none of the water that hits our property goes into the Indian River Lagoon. Now, on that map, you may know this is actually a golf course. This is the moorings golf course. And we think that pollution right there is actually coming off of the sports fields here of St. Ed's. But the moorings golf course all is surrounded by living shorelines, mangroves. And living shorelines are really the ultimate goal. They make a huge difference to the health of the lagoon. So instead of having this, you know, sloping land with all kinds of habitat available for animals, we've just cut it off with this bulkhead, and we've lost all of this community structure. The reason estuaries are so important is because they are the nursery for so many animals that live in the open ocean. And they come in here to spawn because there's hiding places. There's seagrass meadows, and there's mangrove roots, and there's seagrasses that they can hide among And we've removed that. So if you talk to some of the fishermen that used to fish around here in the old days, they used to go out and cast a cast net, and with one cast of the cast net, they got enough bait fish to fish offshore all day long. They go back to the same place and cast a cast net now, and it comes up empty, because there's a seawall there. There's no place for those little fish to hide. So if we could return to living shorelines, that would be even better. They have another tremendous advantage in that they are much more resistant to storm damage. So these are two side-by-side properties. This is what they look like pre-storm, so one with a hardened shoreline, one with a living shoreline. And post-storm, this one's basically been washed away, and this one's still fine. So if we could get with the insurance companies and get them to incentivize homeowners to replace their seawalls with living shorelines, everybody would win. You're going to have to replace your seawall eventually anyway. It's actually cheaper to put in a living shoreline, and it benefits their insurance company. So we just need to start rethinking some of these things and working with nature instead of against it. In looking at sources of pollution, we got an indicator with something that happened at Blue Cypress Lake this summer. For those of you that haven't been to Blue Cypress Lake, you should definitely go. It's an amazing place. It's up near Yeehaw Junction. It's a little lake, no connection to Lake Okeechobee whatsoever. And it's basically undeveloped. There's one tiny little fishing village right here that isn't on septic, it's on sewer. They went on sewer in the 1990s to make sure they protected their precious lake. And it's been subjected to the dumping of biosolids. So, you know, people talk about getting off of septic onto sewer. That's not a solution if, first of all, if your sewage treatment is outdated and leaky, and you've got to understand that it doesn't go away when you send it to a sewer plant. A sewer plant, a water treatment plant, has two outputs. It has a wastewater treatment plant. You've got to use the right terminology. The engineers get mad. It has two outputs. It has reuse water, which we often use to irrigate our golf courses and our lawns. And the trouble is that some of that reuse water is very, very high in nutrients. So people are often fertilizing their lawns while using reuse water and just overdosing with fertilizer. But they also produce biosolids, biosludge. There's much less polite words for it as well. But it's the solid product of a wastewater treatment plant. And it comes out in cake form as Class B biosolids. And it's spread on the land, as you see here, right next to Blue Cypress Lake. And since 2013, between 2013 and 2017, on just Presley Ranch, they spread over 22,338 total dry tons of biosolids. Now, I was horrified when I originally saw that number, but I did the math. And actually, if the bahia grass that they're spreading it on took up all of the nitrogen as it's supposed to, it's actually the right amount. But what they're not calculating is the phosphate. So this is the nitrogen levels between 2003 and 2018 based on Florida Lake Watch data. And actually the nitrogen level has stayed pretty steady even though they've been spreading biosolids. But this is the phosphate, average phosphate levels. And between 2003 and 2006, it stayed pretty steady. And then in 2007, there was one of the ranches, not Presley Ranch, but one north of the lake, that started accepting biosolids. And since then, it has just been steadily climbing. And this is the level it was at when that major algae bloom occurred this summer. Was the worst they've ever seen on Blue Cypress Lake. And that sample that you see there on the right, we tested. And remember I told you the World Health Organization sets the limit in drinking water at 1 part per billion and the recreational exposure at 10 parts per billion? That had 4,700 parts per billion of microcystin in it. And There, this is from the EPA website. These yellow plats are where they're allowed to spread the biosolids. And this is just marshland, and water flows through marshland almost like there's no blockage at all. It's a matter of minutes to get over to the slough over here where we did some of our sampling. And I'm not going to go through the science of all of this. The point, the only take-home point, is that our samplers found Splenda, sucralose basically, and acetaminophen, which is Tylenol. So unless the cattle are having some kind of shindig that we don't understand, this is coming from biosolids. This is human waste, and it's contaminating this lake. These sorts of things are yet another thing that we need to be worrying about with biosolids and wastewater, because sewage is actually becoming the new frontier of public health, thanks to all of the things that end up in our waste stream. So there's birth control pills, antibiotics, personal care products, and all of these things are, you know, related to antimicrobials, pathogens, preservatives, highly fluorinated chemicals. Those are really scary. Artificial sweeteners that stay around forever, flame retardants, detergents, fragrances. It used to be when there were only a few of us, and we didn't actually use all of these products that much, it wasn't a big deal. But there's so many of us now that this is becoming a really big deal. And the problem is that a lot of these things can be taken up by our food crops, so they're getting into our food web. So one of the things that we need to be doing, besides stopping the nutrients directly every possible way we can, is we need to be looking for technological solutions. I'm a real believer in technological solutions to living sustainably, especially if there's going to be this many people on the planet. And somebody else that shares that view is Bill and Melinda Gates. And Bill Gates is very interested in human waste management. And he was interested in attacking one of the worst human waste problems in the world, which is in Dakar, Senegal, where they have absolutely no plumbing, just open pits with human waste in it. And so he went to a guy named Peter Janicki and said, you know, I want you to develop a high-tech wastewater treatment system that solves all of these problems that he listed. And Janicki was an aerospace engineer, and he said, I don't know how to do that. And Gates said, learn, and money is no object. So Janicki did learn, and he's come up with something that, if it works as they claim it works, and I don't have proof that it does as yet, solves all of these problems. So it actually uses the human waste to create energy. It burns it, and it is enough to power the Omni processor and have some left over to sell back to the grid. It produces completely clean water that has no contaminants of emerging concern like all of those that I was listing before, because it's got a very clever method of removing them without degassing them into the environment. And most important of all, I think, is it separates the nitrogen from the phosphorus. It produces the nitrogen as an ammonium liqueur and the phosphorus as a powder. So they can be shipped to separate places. They go back into the cycle because we're a closed system. You don't get rid of anything. You need to reuse it, but you need to reuse it in a smart way. If we start working with nature instead of against it, and we start using our brains to fix these problems, then we can have the kind of Indian River Lagoon that many of us can still remember. This can be fixed, but we need to work together to find the solutions. Thank you.